perhaps even here in the service, there is temptation, there is discouragement, there are trials. Lord, some of us have had things happen in the last few days or in the last few weeks that is a constant. We wake up at night thinking about it. We wake up the next morning. We can't lose it, Lord, and it's taken our joy. It's taken our strength. And you said the joy of the Lord is our strength. So, Lord, I pray that you would give us insight today how to fight and how to win where Satan is attacking. And I pray it wouldn't just be a theological study of the armor of God, but a practical application of the power of God for victory for the people of God. So bless your word to our hearts, our minds, and our wills. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You can be seated. It was during the Constitutional Convention in Philadelphia, one of the members made a motion. His motion was, quote, that the standing army of the newly created United States, the standing army be restricted to 5,000 men at any one time. George Washington, being the chairman, could not offer a motion, but he turned to another member and he whispered sarcastically, amend the motion to provide that no foreign enemy shall invade the United States at any time with more than 3,000 troops. Obviously, we cannot control our enemy, but we can control our preparation to meet him. That's what the armor of God is all about. And today we come to that piece of armor that is the most significant protection that we have when it comes to defense. There in verse 16, let's look at it again. In addition to all, take up the shield of faith. Now, the word shield in Greek actually comes from the Greek word door, thora, door. You say, why is that? Well, it has to do with the shape and the size of the door. I want you to see what a Roman shield looked like. Put that on the screen. They're big. Don't picture a little saucer-type thing that they went in to fight with, you know, that you could use for a frisbee. That's not what we're talking about here. This is the heavy infantry sword. That's why it's called a door, because it was almost the size of a door. In fact, it was 4.5 feet tall by 2.5 feet wide. And when you realize the ancient Romans' average height was about 5'6". I could have been Roman. Anyway, that was the average height. You can see that they could crouch down and actually protect nearly their entire body very easily. Now, this translation in our text, in addition to all, it gives in the footnote of my Bible, in all, technically, the King James probably does a better translation. It just says above all. Now, let's make sure we understand. Paul is not saying this is more important than any other piece of armor. He's not saying that. In addition to all makes it sound like it's the end of a list. It's not the end of the list, so that's probably not a very good translation at all. Above all, the idea is this. This is that one piece of armor that can protect the whole person. None of the rest of the pieces of armor can do that. And by the way, he'll go on to say in the text that it's able, look at verse 16, it's able to extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil. Every temptation, every trial that Satan throws our way. Not some of them, not most of them, not all but one of them, but praise God, all of them. That's how important this is. So the concept of the shield is that it would be something that can be put above us. I'm not sure if that's the second slide, but this is the battle siege where they can actually put the shields above them. And because they would not just shoot these arrows at soldiers, but they would shoot them up in the air and they would use them as a covering above. So the idea of above all starts to make sense to us as far as it being our protection. Now, I'm going to give you a couple principles and some applications as to what this looks like. How does faith become our shield? Obviously, Paul's using it as a metaphor. But if you're taking down notes, you still don't have an outline. I know that. But if you want to take down notes, you can. Put this one down. We have the shield, first of all, that God is. We have the shield that God is. If you are a believer in Jesus Christ, you've come to faith in him, you can know that today. You already have the shield that God is. Why do I say that? Well, jot down Genesis 15 in verse 1. After these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abram in a vision, saying, fear not, Abram, I am thy what? I am your shield and your exceedingly great reward. Walk before me and be blameless. God calls himself our shield. By the way, it's very interesting, this idea of the word shield actually coming from the word door, because in John 10, Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. I am the door, thora, of the sheep. He who believes in me will come in and be saved. But a shepherd would lay himself down out in the wilderness. He would bring his sheep into an enclosed or a tight area, and he would lay himself. I'm actually the door of the sheepfold, you see. And it wasn't just that you came through him as the entrance, but he was what kept you safe after you came in. And so the Lord is our shield. What did David say? Thou, O Lord, are my shield. You're the lifter of my head. Remember what he said after he got in trouble down in Gath with the Philistines? He woke up one day to discover he was hanging out with all the enemies of God's people because it was safer than hanging out with Saul. And there he realized it wasn't too safe there either, as all the Philistines said to the king, what are we doing? This is the guy that killed our champion. This is the enemy. And all of a sudden David's looking around and he doesn't have many friends. And he had to act like he was insane. Remember, he let his drools just drip down into his beard. He walked around like he was crazy. And they said, let's get rid of this nut. And they kicked him out. Well, he wrote Psalm 34 after that experience. And he said, the angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and they're delivered. God, even when I was in the middle of my worst day, by the way, that was one of the low points. He had several, but he was one of my low points of his faith. But he said, you delivered me even then. And there are times God has rescued you from your own sin. He protected you from things that should have taken you out. I want you to jot down Psalm 5, verses 11 and 12. But let all who take refuge in you, Lord, be glad. Let them ever sing for joy, and may you shelter them, that those who love your name may exult in you, for it is you who blesses the righteous man. O Lord, you surround him with favor as with a shield. You remember, this was the complaint of the devil to God about Job. Remember, God was bragging on Job to the devil. Have you noticed? Yes, I noticed him. You notice how he's walking uprightly and he loves me. And yeah, that's because you have put a what? A hedge around him. I can't get to him. There's an obstacle, you know. I remember that Christian comedian came and he talked about that. Why do we as Christians always pray hedges around each other? It comes from Job. He said, you know, we don't understand it. We always pray, God, please put a hedge around Brother Bill. In fact, put around it his whole family, Lord, a hedge of protection. Well, it is biblical. But he said, you know, what do we think? The devil's, you know, afraid of shrubbery or something? He can't get through. But the word in Hebrew just means an obstacle, a wall. Satan says, I can't get through what you have put around him. You have blessed him. That's what Psalm 5 is saying. You've surrounded him with favor. And the fact is, as hard as life might be right now or has ever been for you as a Christian and me, we don't know the half of what God has already protected us from. We'll have to wait till we get to heaven. Some of our angels are going to come probably looking like, do you know what it took to get you here, man? I got squished in several car accidents. You know, I mean, they're going to come tell us what it took. Shield, it's just around you. Take it for granted. That was just graduated out of high school. A friend of mine and I thought we'd go out and explore the world, you know. You're done, your shackles, school's out forever. And so we bought motorcycles, street bikes, and decided, let's go. Where do you want to go? I don't know. Where do you want to? Let's figure it out, you know. Let's go to Arizona. Now, we graduated in June. No problem. So we got on our motorcycles, and we took off for Tucson, Arizona, in the heat. And, you know, if you go through the desert in June on a motorcycle that has no windshield, you start to discover why windshields are a good idea. Because every June bug is a bullet smacking you at as fast as you're going, 70, 80, yep. And miserable, you know. We take it for granted, the things that God is protecting us from all the time. We don't even know it. Job was not aware of how Satan had wanted to get to him. He would become aware. But the idea in the scripture is very clear. Our shield is God. And our faith is in him. But as we have discovered along the way on each piece of the armor, this is not talking about that aspect. It's true, he is a shield, but now we're being told to take up something. So that's something we have automatically. It's something more than just faith in God. We're not saying you need to have faith in God. This is not so much an evangelistic message for the unbeliever as it is an equipment message for the believer. Put this down then, if you're taking notes. We need to take up the shield that God gives. We're to have the shield that God is. As believers, we have it, but we're to take up the shield that God gives. That's what the text says very clearly. Take up the shield of faith. Okay, well, what does that involve? Our faith must be held and directed. Think of a shield. It's not enough to own one. You could own one and leave it at home and go out to the battle. What a fool you are. Oh, no, it actually has to be used, and it has to be held, and it has to be directed in the direction of the attack. It's not enough to have one. I don't know how many of you remember this. This is going way back now. Maxwell Smart. There's a play on words right there, the kind of oxymoron just in his name, I think, right? Secret Agent 86. And he has got every imaginable gadget to protect him and to fight against the agents of evil, chaos. And in one episode, one of the chaos agents is there, has a gun on him, and in his apartment. And he pushes a button, and you hear this noise of something moving. And he tells a guy, there's a bulletproof invisible force field between me and you. You can't hurt me at all. And the guy says, really? He goes, that's right. And the guy reaches out and touches Max on the nose. And Max goes, doc, doc, doc. Came down right behind him. It's not enough to have a shield if it's not in the right place. And there are plenty of Christians who have their shield of faith and it's right there in church. And they leave it right there as they leave. It has to be in the right place, pointed in the direction of the attack. Spurgeon talked about this at length on this passage, that the idea is we need to know Scripture, specific Scripture, to answer for the temptation and the trial that we're facing. When Jesus was tempted to turn stones into bread, he didn't just trust the Father generally. He quotes Deuteronomy 8:3 specifically that says, man shall not live by bread alone. We need to know our Bible so we know what to build our faith up and respond. Where are you being tempted? Where are you being tried? That's why it's so important. The psalmist says, thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Going way back, since we're talking get smart, I might as well do another one. Andy of Mayberry has a partner. Barney Fife, who isn't exactly fit for the job, but he's all he's got. So you might remember, at least in one episode, Barney carries a gun, but he's not allowed to have bullets in it. He has one bullet, and it's put in his pocket. And if he really needs to, he's one. I think there are some Christians who've got like one bullet. You know, when it comes to answering temptation. But it may not be it's not what you need, you know. You're going through some horrible trial and you're like, thus saith the Lord, Jesus wept. You know, it's like, I'm not sure how that relates, but no, we're to point the shield of faith in the direction of the attack. And that means that we have a knowledge of the Word of God where we can do that. That's why God's Word is so important. It is a no deposit, no return kind of a policy. Jesus said the Holy Spirit will bring to remembrance the things that I've said, but they've heard them, and now he's bringing them to mind. He can't bring to mind what you've never heard, never read, never believed, don't know. And then another principle is this: the shield is what helps us endure the attack. I want you to jot down James 4 and verse 7. James says, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. And the picture is of being in a battle that's going to take some time. Resist the devil, he's attacking you, and eventually he will flee from you. Now, the reason I say this is, frankly, these shields that the Romans carried would enable them to endure an attack. In fact, they would allow their enemy to hack away at them just until their enemy became exhausted. And then, of course, they would reach out and thrust them through. And the idea is we're going to still experience attack. It says not like the shield makes us to where we're oblivious to attack. We're going to endure it. Remember, that's what 1 Corinthians 10:13 says. No trial, no temptation has overtaken you, but such as is common to man. And God's faithful. He won't allow you to be tried. We love that part of the verse. He won't allow you to be tempted beyond what you're able, but with the temptation or the trial will provide a way of escape that you may be able to, what is the next two words? Endure it. The way of escape. God spells escape, E-N-D-U-R-E. I wish he didn't. I want out. God says through. It's not about getting you out. It's about getting you ready for heaven, you see. And he's going to try your faith. He's going to make it better. Some of you are going through trials you've never been through before, and you can't imagine how you're going to make it through, but God's gotten you ready for it. You know what it says of Abraham when he offered up Isaac? It came about after these things that God said, go offer your son. In other words, everything that God had done in his life up to that point, it came about after these things, and the same thing is true with your life. You're ready. I'm not ready. You're ready. God knows us better than we do. But we have to endure the trial, so our shields have to be able to withstand. You know, Solomon had shields made of gold. They were taken by the enemy, of course. So his son Rehoboam replaced them, not with shields of gold, but with shields of brass. Talking about different levels or qualities. You know, there in the Bible, it speaks of faith, and there are different levels of faith. Did you know there are actually five? You can jot them down if you want. Five levels of faith mentioned in the Scripture. The first level should be obvious. First of all, there's that level of, put it on the screen, no faith at all. No faith. Mark 4:40, Jesus said to his disciples there in the storm, why is it that you have no faith? And these aren't unbelievers. These aren't people who don't know Jesus. These are Jesus followers. These are his closest followers. And there are times in our life, maybe some of us right here in this room, we have got no faith at all in the storm we're in, if we're honest. Secondly, there's little faith. We hear a lot about that. Oh, ye of little faith. Jesus said that on more than one occasion to the same guys. And maybe that's more of a description of you. You don't understand, Jesus, why are you sleeping in my storm? I'd like you to be bailing out water at least. If you're not going to end it, at least help us get the water out. Oh, ye of little faith. Then, thirdly, there is what we would call weak faith, what God calls weak faith. Now, it speaks of it in the negative sense concerning Romans 4:19, referring to Abram. It says, being not weak in faith. He wasn't, but that is a condition you can have. Being weak in faith, similar to little faith, but a different description. You have faith, but it's not strong. And then fourthly, in the very next verse, it says, he wasn't weak, but he was strong in faith, and he gave glory to God in his condition. And then finally, fifthly, of course, remember what Jesus said, of two people, actually interesting, both Gentiles. The centurion, who believed if he just spoke the word, his servant could be healed. He didn't need to come to his house. He said, I haven't seen such great faith, not in all of Israel. And of the Syrophoenician woman, who was a Gentile, who wanted Jesus to come heal her demon-possessed daughter. And although the disciples tried to dissuade her, all she said, Lord, the dogs get the crumbs. And he said, woman, your faith is great. Now, I don't know what Jesus would say to you this morning about the storm, the trial, the problem with your child that you're going through, but we can see that there are different levels of faith. Listen, the salesman took a shortcut through the countryside, miscalculated the miles, ran out of gas on a lonely road next to a synagogue. He didn't find anybody there, so he walked a mile and down to it happened to be a Catholic convent where he was greeted by one of the sisters. He said, my car's out of gas. Do you have any spare gas? They did, but they couldn't find a container to hold it. Finally, the sister appeared carrying the only thing she could find, which happened to be a bedpan. With a gallon of gas in the bedpan, the salesman and nun walked back to the car. With the man behind the wheel, the nun carefully poured the gas from the bedpan into the tank. Before she finished, she noticed a Jewish rabbi was watching her pour the gas out of the bedpan into the tank. And then the rabbi said, "All I can say, sister, is you have more faith than me." Different kinds of faith in the Bible, different qualities of the shield. Look, when I was a police officer, I would not have worn a bulletproof vest that was rated to withstand a BB gun. And some of us, our faith is so weak. Our faith is so little. Or maybe we have none at all, and we're finding ourselves getting whooped just about every day. How do we ask for and receive what the disciples asked of Jesus when they said simply, "Lord, increase our faith. I need more faith for what I'm going through, what you're asking me to do." I want to give you some principles from the Word of God. There are four of them. They'll be on the screen one at a time. First of all, we need to learn, every one of us, to rest in God's presence, to rest in the presence of God. Why do I say that? Well, I think you'll know as you get into Scripture how important God's presence is to faith. Remember what David wrote, "Yea, though I walk," you know the verse, "yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for I am a studly warrior." Oh, no, that's not exactly what he said, is it? "I will fear no evil, for," yeah, "I have your presence with me." It is key, not just to David, but all through Scripture. No matter what I'm going through, I won't be able to have the kind of faith I need to unless I'm aware of the presence of God. It's like that child, the boy who came home from the first day at school. He was, I don't know, second or third grade. And next morning, he didn't want to get out of bed and go to school. And his dad said, "Get up. You got to go to school." He goes, "No, I'm not going." He goes, you're going to school." He goes, "No, I'm not." He said, "Why not?" He goes, "Yesterday I walked down, and before I got to the school, this bully came out, hit me, took my lunch money, and he said, 'I'll see you tomorrow.' He said, 'Daddy, I'm not going to school today.' He said, 'You're going. Get dressed.' I said, 'No, Daddy, please.' He said, 'Get dressed.' Made his son, who was in tears, get dressed, and then he walked him to school. And all of a sudden, he's holding on to the hand of his father, who was about 6'4 and 250. Couldn't wait to see that kid down the street, actually. See, this is the idea. You might feel, as a believer, very alone. You might feel left by God. You don't feel his presence. You don't see him doing anything. You feel God forsaken. Can I tell you something? You can feel that way, but never describe yourself as God forsaken. You're not. God said, "I will never leave you nor forsake you." You might not sense it, but he's there. There are only two God-forsaken places in the universe. One of them is not Bakersfield, by the way, just in case you were wondering, or wherever. If you're from Bakersfield, I'm sorry. Believe me, I have other cities I can substitute. Two God-forsaken places in the universe. One of them is hell, where men will suffer, listen to me, away from the presence of God forever. The damned. The other God-forsaken place is Calvary, where Jesus, when God judged him with your sin and mine, cried out, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, my God, why have you," what? "Forsaken me." And you know why God forsook him then, because he never wanted to forsake you. Oh no, you are not forgotten. You are not left. A child of God, God is with you even when you can't feel his presence. So we need to get into, we need to seek, we need to be in the presence of God. Listen, I don't know what you're facing. Lots of stuff in this room right now. Some of you, nobody knows but you in this room. For some of you, nobody knows but you in this world. I don't know what your Jericho is that you're staring at across the swollen Jordan. I don't know who the giants are that God is calling you to face, but I got news for you. The words of God to Joshua are his words to you. Be strong and very courageous, for I am with you. I will go through this with you. He doesn't expect you to do it on your own. So if we're going to have the kind of faith we need to get through our trials, we've got to rest in God's presence. Then secondly, learn to rely on God's promises. Rely on God's promises. You know, as people read through the book of Genesis, you come to this trial that I mentioned earlier where God told Abram to offer up his only son. Now we read that because we know it's in there and we know how it turns out, but Abram didn't know how that was going to turn out that day. He didn't have the end of Genesis. He didn't have the end of this chapter. He just had the command of God. And how in the world could God ever require that? How could God tell anybody to offer their son? How could Abraham ever obey that one? Well, that's a question we don't have to wonder about, actually, because it's answered in the Bible. We actually know how Abraham was able to obey that kind of a command. You can jot it down. It's Hebrews 11, verses 17 through 19. We're told in the New Testament. Hebrews 11. By faith, Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac. Listen to this now. He who had received the promises, that's referring to Abraham, was offering up his only son. It was he, Abraham, to whom it had been said previously, in Isaac, this boy he was being told to offer up, your descendants or your seed shall be called. Say, well, what's your point? Abraham knew that God made a promise to him that Isaac was going to have children. He wasn't even married yet. He had no children. But he had a promise from God that his lineage, his legacy, was going to come through this boy who that promise had never been fulfilled yet. It goes on in the book of Hebrews to describe the fact. Here it is. He considered that God is able to raise people even from the dead. In other words, I'm being told I'm going to kill my son, that God's going to have to raise him from the dead. Why? Because his promise is going to be kept. You see, the promise of God will give you the ability to have the faith that you need in the circumstances, the trial, or the temptations that you're facing. You know, a lot of times we don't see things the way they really are. We don't know what God's doing. We don't see God doing anything. We think we see what's happening and we get so discouraged, but we're so narrow. Do you know, I don't know if you know this, if you read this last week, on Thursday, just this last Thursday, the universe got 10 times bigger. Did you know that? Say, no, it didn't. I'm just telling you what I read. Okay, no, it didn't get 15 or 10 times bigger. It was discovered to be 10 times bigger. They used to say, and for years I used to quote, 100 billion galaxies in the known universe. Now they're saying, that was 2 trillion. We made a mistake. 15-year study, we realized it was way bigger than we thought. Can I tell you, that's the way it ought to be. Man should just humble himself and say, I don't really know how big it is. It's probably a lot bigger than that too, but we just have instruments that can only go so far, Hubble, deep space, but someday, maybe farther. We don't know much, except that we don't know much. And let me tell you something. We don't know much about what God is doing in our lives right now. We don't. And that's why God says, you just trust my word. You can know who I am and what I do. I've revealed myself in the scriptures, and you have my promises. You know, some of you know this, some of you don't. We have a gymnasium, and when we moved into this building, the architect and I were walking around and trying to figure out how to use the space, and I said, it'd be wonderful if we could have a gym. And I said, this looks like it might be big enough. And he says, yeah, I think it is. I said, there's only one drawback. I said, there's a pillar in the middle of the room. I go, it would make for a very interesting game of basketball. And so I said, can we remove the pillar? He said, I don't know, but we'll get an engineer out here and check it out. So they sent an engineer out. He looked at the pillar, looked at the roof. He said, good news. He said, this pillar was put in so that a previous company could put heavy equipment on the roof. He said, they took the equipment with them. You can take the pillar out. It's like, yes, gymnasium. And so our guys that were helping us with demolition to save some money, I took the pillar out. 2 weeks later, the roof collapsed. I mean, the entire third section of the church's roof collapsed. Sheared off the water main, flooded the entire church. Everywhere you're studying, you would have been floating right now in church. I mean, the elevator shaft full of water. It was a huge catastrophe. I remember they called me. Water was pouring out of every door. The police, the fire department was here. The news helicopter was up above. Yeah, it was one of those days. And I was up on a boom looking at this horrible hole. And I didn't know how much it was going to cost, but I figured it was more than we had planned. It was, we didn't have any money for that. And so I'm on the phone with our insurance company, who we had just hired. I mean, we just bought the building. It's not like they were involved with us for years. And I said, hi, I'm a pastor of a church, and we've got a little bit of a roof problem. Just wanting to know if it might be covered. And the agent on the phone, who I'd never met in person, said, oh, well, very few roof problems are ever covered by insurance. I just thought I'd tell you that. I go, okay, well, when are they covered? And he said, well, there's, I think he said seven. He got the policy out. There's seven reasons why a roof would be covered. And like, check, check, check. He read them off to me. It's like, no, it wasn't that. No, it wasn't snow. You know, whatever it was, you know, just right through the list. And I'm thinking, we're dead, you know. And he came to the very last one, and it said something about defective workmanship. I'm like, nah, I didn't cover it. And so he said, well, what happened? I said, well, our demolition team did a little more demolition than they intended. They came in and they took the pillar out because this engineer had told us it was safe and it wasn't. He said, I think that could be considered defective workmanship. I said, are you serious? He said, yeah. I said, so how much of it's covered? He said, the whole thing. It was over $100,000 of damage. It was completely covered. And I remember just being able to go back to the elders and go, well, I have bad news and good news. Bad news is we don't have a roof in most of our building and it's flooded with water. The good news is it's all covered. Can I tell you something, friends? We do need to know the policy. We need to know it well for ourselves, but we need to know it for one another. When someone tells you they're going through a difficult time in their family or a difficult time with their work or their finances or their medical, we need to have compassion. We need to pray for them. We need to not tell them how we made it through it ourselves. We just need to encourage them, but we also need to say, I have good news for you. I've checked the policy. It is covered. We have an umbrella policy. It's Romans 8:28. All things are working, including whatever you're going through. And I don't mean to trivialize it, but we do need to trust it. If we're going to use the shield, we need to rely on God's promises. Put this down. Be refreshed by God's provision. By God's provision. There were three types of arrows they would use in ancient warfare. The type you think of, a typical bow and arrow to shoot. And the archers would shoot. Also, an arrow that they would light on fire. Might have pitch or something flammable on the tip. Shoot that at a wooden structure, a hut, or sometimes at soldiers. And the shield here, it says, and this is important to the verse, you got to get this, because it says, you'll be able to extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. The most serious type of damage that could be done was neither of the two arrows I mentioned, but it was actually a reed, almost like a piece of bamboo, hollowed out, that was filled with a flammable substance called naphtha. Naphtha is like gasoline or lighter fluid, and they would mix it with alcohol. And the it's not about the arrow. The arrow is just the delivery mechanism. It's about the afterburn after it hits, you see. The arrow itself is not the big deal. The shield can handle the arrows, fine. It's all the fire that came out from it after the fact, which would burn everything around it, you see. And that's what he's talking about here. This shield, when you have the shield of faith, you're going to be able to extinguish every flaming missile the enemy throws at your way. Think of it this way. There is that day when Saul hears that song on the radio he doesn't like. Remember it? He liked part of the song. Saul has slain his thousands. He used to sing that part. He didn't like the second half of the song. But David is tens of thousands. Huh? Take that one off the radio right now. And that little arrow of envy, it wasn't just when he heard the song, it was the afterburn that became in his own heart murderous. Cain's offering was not offered up. Hard day, sad day, could have gotten that fixed. Oh no, it turned into not only a depression, but a murderous anger and hatred. Ammon thought Tamar looked good, and he lusted after her. That was the arrow of temptation. That would turn into rape. You see, it's not just the thing that happens, it's what happens afterwards so often in our life. We go through a loss in our life and we're sad, but then depression sets in. We get hurt, and then anger and resentment become a way of life. Maybe you get bad news at work or at the doctor, but the future is uncertain, and all of a sudden you go from worry and start to dread what is going to happen, and life seems to swirl around your circumstances. Let's remember, a lowly acorn can turn into the sky falling if you let it. And this is exactly what I believe happens so often. You know, it says in Hebrews, it talks about all these feats of faith that men in the Old Testament accomplished. They shut lions' mouths, talking about Daniel, and these various men and women who by faith did various things. And then it says this there, by faith they quenched the violence of fire. Now you know immediately who it's talking about. That's Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego's faith. Remember, they were told to bow down or they'd be cast into the fiery furnace, and they refused to bow down to the idol, so they were cast into the furnace. You remember the story. The fire didn't burn them at all. In fact, all it did was burn off their bonds. It didn't ruin them. It just revealed the Lord was with them. And I love that passage of Scripture because it reminds me of this passage of Scripture. In Isaiah, God says, when you walk through the fire, he didn't say, I'll give you a different route. He said, when you walk through the fire, you will not be burned, and it will not kindle upon you. So these shields were able to handle these flaming missiles of the enemy. How did they do that? Well, let me explain something to you that maybe you don't know about shields. A soldier would have to prepare his shield for battle. Did you know that? It wasn't just like he had to take it and point it in the right direction. That wasn't enough. No, every day, a soldier going into battle would take his shield and soak it in water. And then he would rub oil all over it. You say, what? Yep. I don't know if you've ever had a problem with chapped lips, but if you go to a dermatologist, here's what he's going to tell you to do. Don't just put on chapstick and just seal in the dryness. Get your lips wet, then put on some kind of balm to seal it in. That's the idea here. These wooden shields that were covered with leather hides, they weren't metal, had to be soaked in water and then covered in oil. Jot it down, Isaiah 21, verse 5. It refers to this. Rise up, O captains, oil the shields. The water and the oil were the fire suppression system, you might say, that allowed the shield to actually handle the fiery arrow and not just survive, but to put it out. And that's interesting to me. Our faith needs both water and oil. You know, I remember I was coming home from Biola. I was a student there. And I remember exactly where I was. I can picture myself in my car. And I was thanking the Lord. I had this thought come into my mind. It was kind of a novel thought. I said, Lord, thank you. I haven't had a single problem in 6 months. No, it wasn't because I just, you know, I had a head-on car collision as I finished my prayer. It wasn't in preparation for some evil thing to happen. It was just an awareness that I really sensed I had not had a single problem in my life. And then immediately it dawned on me that wasn't true. What was true was, although I've had normal things happening like everybody, they hadn't affected me the way they normally did. And then it dawned on me, why? And I didn't really put it together until that moment. The Lord had started in my life a new habit. I had been challenged to be in God's Word and to pray every day. And I had started making that my discipline. Get up at 5:30 in the morning, spend time with the Lord. And I didn't realize it, but 6 months into it, I realized, you know what? That's the same amount of time I've been spending in the Word and praying every day. Now, in retrospect, I feel differently about the things that have been coming into my life. They're still coming into my life. No different, really. But I'm different. You got to soak your faith in the water of the Word of God. You need to be anointed with fresh oil. That's the filling of the Spirit of God. That's what the Scriptures, I believe, are teaching us very clearly here. Now, in an evangelical church like ours, a lot of us, not all of us, but a lot of us are committed to reading our Bible every day. We have our devotion. But I want to encourage you to do more than simply read. I want you to read. But I want you to ask God to fill you with the Holy Spirit. I believe we have a real danger in thinking, well, that's something that happens when you get baptized in the Spirit and there's this experience and then see in heaven, Lord. And from time to time, if he visits you with that, ooh, that'll be nice. No, that's not what the scriptures teach at all. We need to read the Bible and pray every day. Jot down Jude, verse 20. Jude, verse 20. You say, what chapter? Yep, that one. But you, beloved, build yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. Now, I know there are those who claim that that's speaking in tongues. I don't believe it is at all. That's not talking about speaking in tongues in context. It's talking about praying in dependence on and really motivated by the Spirit of God. We don't know how to pray as we ought. The Spirit prays with utterances too deep for words. Not talking about tongues either. Spirit-led, Spirit-filled prayer. I'm going to build myself on my holy faith. How do I do it? I get in the Word of God. Why? Faith comes by hearing and hearing the Word of God. You will not have strong faith if you neglect the Word of God. But you can have dry faith if that's all you do. And if your shield, if you just got it wet and there was no oil, it would burn, baby, burn. You needed the water and the oil. Now, with regard to this ministry of the Holy Spirit, the rubbing of the oil, this picture, I want to remind us of something that I think we forget too. I think sometimes we think, well, I'm going to go to this prayer meeting or I'm going to go to this church service and I'm going to worship God and I'm going to get close to God because I'm going to think about him. The Bible's going to be read. We're going to sing songs. I'm going to be around Christians and I'm going to get filled up. I feel close to God and then I go back into my other world and I go to work and I have my family and my friends and suddenly I just feel a drain. It's like I got to get back to church to get a little more of that spiritual filling. But you know what? You need to understand the filling of the Spirit is not supposed to work that way. Look, I did not fill up my tank yesterday, my car gas tank. I probably won't fill it up today either. You know why? It's not empty. I don't fill it up every day. I only fill it up when it's empty. But you and I are not spiritual gas tanks. We're not spiritual batteries that hold a charge. We get a charge once a week or twice a week. No, Jesus describes us in John 15. He said, I am the vine, you are the branches. He said, abide in me, like a branch to a vine, for apart from me you can do nothing. That's not a battery. He doesn't say, you know, I'll give you some juice and then go out there and bear fruit and come back and connect again. Sorry, you disconnect the vine, it dies. It's a constant connection or no connection. So we don't wait to be filled with the Spirit every few months. We're not like an airplane that gets filled up and I'm going to go soar in the Lord and then I got to land every once in a while at LAX. I hate it, but I need the gas. No, it's mid-air refueling. That's what we need. We need to let the Spirit of God, the Bible says, be being filled. We have a slide there. That's what we need right there. The Spirit of God is to fill us even in flight every day. Washed in the Word, soaked in the Word, anointed by the Spirit. Every spiritual attack. Remember what Paul says in Acts? People are worried about his future. He wasn't worried about it, even though he knew it was going to get worse. Maybe if you knew today how bad it was going to get, you know, you're like, God can't trust some of us with that. It's like we'd freak out, so he doesn't tell us. Paul knew. He says, you know, I really don't know exactly what's going to happen when I get to Jerusalem. Don't know. Said, oh, the only thing I do know is that bonds and affliction await me. And then he said this, but none of these things move me. I don't consider my life of any account. I just want to finish the course. I want to honor God to the end. However it's going to end. It's not about this life anymore for him. None of these things even move me, even though I know it's going to get worse. It's pretty amazing faith. Like that song that said, praise the Lord, hallelujah. I really don't care what the devil's going to do because the word and faith are my sword and shield and Jesus is Lord of the way I feel. That's the kind of faith that Paul had. Well, put this down finally. We need to be reinforced by God's people. We need to rest in God's presence, rely on his promises, be refreshed by his provision, the water and the oil, but we need to be reinforced by God's people. In the text, of course, it says, in addition to all, taking up the shield of faith with which you, we'll be able to extinguish all the flaming missiles of the enemy. But the word you is plural. He's talking to a whole church, so that makes sense. But we ought to understand something about the shield. The effectiveness of the shield is not just one soldier out there fighting by himself. That's the way we always tend to think about our spiritual warfare. It's me and God against the devil. That's not the way God pictures us. You are part of an army. And the interesting thing about the Roman shield was a formation that they actually stole from the Greeks, because it was so effective from the Greek army that the Romans started using it. Very effective. It's called the formation of the phalanx. And this is what they would do. They would line their shields up. They could actually link them physically up to one another. Sometimes they would stand in formation an entire mile of guys, and they would march together. There was absolutely nothing the enemy could do on the front lines to stop them when they did this. Our shields are not just what we can do by ourselves, but they're a part of a system of protection God intends us to understand. You know, the Bible says to bear one another's burdens. It says three times in the New Testament, encourage one another. We have a relationship and a responsibility to fight for one another. We'll discover in verse 18, when you get your armor all on, you're to pray for the saints, you see. The battle isn't just ours, but it's ours for one another as well. I think of when David, who was so open to God using him. Remember, Samuel had anointed him to be king. And he didn't know how or when that was going to happen, but that's a pretty exciting thing to be planning for your future. And as it was, God used him, remember, to slay Goliath. That was huge. He became like a general in the army. He had been a song worshiper for the king. He married this king's daughter. I mean, his best friend was Jonathan, the prince apparent to the throne. I mean, he was close to royalty. And it seemed like it was kind of happening. Didn't know exactly what God was going to do. He thought maybe something's going to break. But this thing happened where this envy came into Saul. And Saul tried to kill him with a spear. And so David ran because Saul's kind of nuts right now. And, you know, Saul would go up and down depending on what music was being played and evil spirit and, you know, all that. He kind of bipolar guy having trouble, you know. And here's David, and he's wanting to hear word back. Is it safe to come back to the palace? The Bible tells us in Samuel that Jonathan goes out to meet David secretly in the wood, and he does not have good news for him. The news isn't dad's gotten over his bad attitude, come back and play some music, he'll be fine. He has to say, you got to run. You got to run for your life, and I can't go with you. But I love what it says. It says Jonathan, who's the older, by the way, of the two, Jonathan comes out and says he strengthened David's hand in God. Maybe you need that today, but maybe you're sitting next to or near somebody or going to meet somebody who needs just that. Maybe you're going to be someone's Jonathan this week. You're going to strengthen their trust in God. Yeah, it's not easy what's happening, and I can't tell you when it's going to end. God's promises are still true. You're still going to wind up on the throne. But I can't tell you that's next week, David. It could be 10 years from now. I have no idea. All I know is you've got to run. Things are not okay. But I want you to know you can trust God through this. We need to line up our shields and connect with one another. And I'll say what I've said so many times. Please don't be a lone ranger spiritually. There's so many lone rangers in our world, in our church. Say, well, that's just kind of who I am. Hey, even Lone Ranger had a Tonto. You need somebody. That's why I challenge some of you that feel like you're a loner. You feel all alone. Join an agape group. Let yourself be known. Let yourself be vulnerable. Become part of a group of other Christians who know what's going on, who are praying for you, who are strengthening your hand and allowing you to strengthen theirs. Last little slide I want to show you is a formation that I found. This is how they would march when they would come up to a fortress. You say, what is that? That's called the tuatto. That's Latin for the turtle formation. They actually would put their shields in front of them, on the sides of them, and over their heads. So no matter what the enemy threw at them, they were completely protected. But they couldn't do that with one shield by themselves. It demanded that they have a relationship with other people who were using their shields together to protect them. Let's pray. Father, as we learn